Here's the area. It's approximately 1,000 acres, and it's bounded by the Inner Harbor on the west, very close to downtown. On the east, we're over at Leslie Street by Aquinas Bay. To the north is the railway, and to the south is what you may know as Cherry Beach, and then, of course, the Outer Harbor. What we've done here for an area comparison, because you might be more familiar with traveling through the downtown area, we have mapped out the downtown with the outline of the Portlands. So you could build another downtown in this Portlands. That's how large it is. So what you see is the map of from Spadina to Sherbourne and from Dundas down to Front with an outline around it to describe to you. So this is actually the downtown map. We basically just cut it and pasted it into the Portlands area. This would be where City Hall is, where the convention center is, and it starts to give you a sense of how massive this area is. And just think how long it took to build our downtown, and then try to imagine what it means to plan an area of this scale all at once. So where did we start? Well, this land didn't actually exist. So, you know, we have the original shoreline of the lake is here, and this is our shoreline today. So the dotted line is our shoreline today, and the solid line is the shoreline of the original edge of Lake Ontario. So the Portlands, which is this area over here, was one of the largest marshes on the Great Lakes. And over time, as industry developed and as we built our city, we began to landfill it and build out on that area. One of the plans that came forward from the Toronto Harbour Commissioner, interestingly, pretty much 100 years ago today, is this plan for the Portlands. And you can see there's this notional idea of a park right against Lake Ontario. And in the Waterfront Toronto plans, we have something called Lake Ontario Park, which is interesting. We're still planning for a park there. We have parts of it. We do have Cherry Beach. We have you know, the Outer Harbor and so forth. And so these things take time. Another key message here. There's the Portland's history. Chris does this one really well. So
you see on these three photos, you can see on the left, they're building the ship channel there. And if you look closely, the dock walls that are there are built out of wood timbers. That dock wall hasn't been upgraded in the last 100 years. So that's an indication of exactly the type of infrastructure that we're dealing with. We have to remediate these dock walls if we do anything with them, and that's an additional cost that we have to bear. If you look on the top right, that's Villiers Street. Those tracks still exist today. It's unclear whether or not they're still used, probably not. But if we're going to redo that road, we have to remove tracks. We're going to have to deal with the infrastructure that's underneath them and basically put everything in new. So that's an additional cost that we have to deal with. Bottom right-hand corner is one of the original oil tanks being constructed. That's a legacy problem that we have to deal with soil contamination remediation that occurred for roughly about 80 years in the Portlands.
Okay. Here you can see more of the same, kind of an aerial view of the specific location of all the oil tanks that existed throughout the Portlands. In the north, in the top of the slide, is the Keating Channel, and above that is the neighborhood that we're referring to now as Keating Precinct. So you can see there's quite a bit of both geological issues in terms of it being landfill, and then geo-environmental issues in terms of the nature of the soil with the industries that existed here. So
up until, well, this looks like around the late 70s, early 80s, we can start to see some of the industrial uses, the heavy industrial uses start to decline. We're starting to see some scrap metal operations, and that's actually the site where the Sound Academy driving range is today. So heavy metal contamination on that site, again, another issue that we have to deal with.
So these are the great views in terms of opportunity. You get a sense from this aerial of just how close the Portlands really is to the downtown and what the relationship can be. It's a completely different view of the skyline. It's kind of this northwest, north-south cut through. You're looking from the east back towards the city. This area here, of course, is quite built out now. Here it's the blank slate, but if you go there today, you can actually drive through on Bayview and see the completed Don River Park. It won't be open for a year, but that's the area of the Pan Am Games, and we'll get to that in a minute as I move through this.
So what is the planning history? Well, in the 1990s, the City of Toronto started to look at the Portlands to try to figure out just how we're going to deal with this on a go-forward basis. And that led to a document called Unlocking the Portlands, which in 1999 tried to put some clarity on how do you strike a balance between the existing port uses and the emerging land uses for the Portlands. In 2003, Council adopted the Central Waterfront Secondary Plan for the entire Central Waterfront, which was pretty much what the broad objectives were for the redeveloped waterfront. In 2005, Waterfront Toronto took on a Portlands implementation strategy that provided additional clarity to the Portlands. And in 2008, the City of Toronto adopted a community improvement plan to try to provide financial incentives to address brownfield remediation and attract creative industries to the Portlands and other areas of the waterfront. This work ended in, or led us to the Lower Donlands Plan in 2010, which is what most of you are familiar with which basically set out a mixed-use community for about 200 acres of the 1,000 acres in Portland.
So just to walk through those, this is the first piece, the Unlocking the Portlands. As Chris mentioned, we start from the west with the Quay and Inner Harbor District, then Cherry Street Corridor, the Business District, as he was mentioning, where do we take those industries if we move them away from the edge? Finally, an industrial employment district, which you see will tie into a later study that was done as well. And then finishing off with the Leslie Street corridor, we've done some Leslie Street greening over the last few years, so that now the cycle path from Leslie connecting down to the Spit is much more inviting and easier to navigate. This is the original Central Waterfront Secondary Plan from 2003. You can see there's already a beginning of figuring out how to deal with flood protection, the river cutting through where Keating Channel had been, with a notion about a park to the south, which at that point was called Commissioner's Park. So a lot of the parkland has moved around. It's always been the same amount, but sort of moved around through the site as we've come to different challenges and opportunities. 2005, we continue with this notion that's pretty much set, that basically mixed-use neighborhoods will stay closer to East Bayfront and West Donlands. Film studios have begun to develop and they are growing over time. They're kind of at the nexus of the relationship between the mixed-use neighborhoods and the industries which are moving even further east to make way for the changes to the west. And then finally to the north, sort of an employment area that is focused on the industrial. And this is the community improvement plan.
Yeah, so this you can see here the different areas that were identified for financial incentives by the city. West Donlands and East Bayfront, obviously emerging areas that are under development today. The Portlands, for the most part, is covered in that, with the exception of the Hatched area. That was excluded because the Lower Donlands plan was being developed and also because there was no servicing south of the Ship Channel, so they didn't want to encourage too many uses down there. And then south of Eastern, which is the yellow area, we'll get to that in a minute, but that's another area that the city was looking for incentives to try to attract creative industries.
So here's the, so you saw previously the 2003 plan, here's the 2010 plan. So the 2003 plan had the river further north. If you'll remember, it was kind of more up in this area, and then we brought it down here. So some of the thinking about that as problems came on board in terms of how do you really bring a river through under the Gardner. There were a lot of kind of infrastructure issues that really didn't make sense to bring a river through there, so it was pulled south. Also, Keating Channel is really considered, you know, at the time it was a monumental piece of work to do. Why not save it and celebrate it for what it is, a kind of an urban structure, urban canal that, you know, a city doesn't really have something like that right now. Many of our other partner, you know, Canadian cities like Ottawa and Montreal have that kind of an amenity. It would be great to do that here. We have the channel around which to build. Bring the river south. Ship Channel, of course, stays where it is as well. But the big piece of this that, you know, what we've been undertaking over the last few months is to really look at this in relationship to the entire Portlands. So if this is flood protecting the entire Portlands, then we should certainly be looking at the whole Portlands in this discussion.
So what's the related activity around the Portlands that we have to take into consideration? Well, we have the East Bayfront community that's being developed. We have the West Donlands as well. South of Eastern, which we mentioned, is an employment area that's being looked at. There's also the TTC LRV facility, which brings an interesting transit opportunity to the Portlands.
So East Bayfront, How many of you have been to Sugar Beach yet? Or excellent, excellent. So there's Sugar Beach at night with the splash pads lit up. And East Bayfront, as you know, then is well underway, and it ties very nicely into the connecting to the Portlands area as we move further east. And also what the work that we've done here does is kind of set us up for learning from what we know about the soil and the you know, depth of bedrock and how you bring projects forward. You know, building near the lake is a very different thing than building in the center of the city somewhere. There are all sorts of issues that you have to consider when, you know, in terms of weather, in terms of land condition, and in terms of making sure that you work with the in-water works. Here's West Donlands. As I mentioned, Bayview's now open, so you can drive along Bayview, and you'll be driving right past Don River Park, which is almost completely built out now and will be the park that works with the Pan Am Village when that's completely built out.
So south of Eastern, Employment Lands, that's the area around the circle in a large black line. Right now, the city is undertaking a five-year official plan review. And as part of that, they're doing an employment land study for the entire city. And what that study will do, and I believe that study should be done by the end of May, is provide clarity on just what the city wants to do with these employment lands. And it'll provide clarity on what's happening with these lands, because right now they're a little bit in limbo, especially with the Portlands project, which is a different land use category, which is regeneration area, which allows for mixed use. So right now, the two categories provide basically a line separating them. What we'd like to see is more of an integration, more of a synergy between the two different land uses along the Lakeshore Corridor. What this is Toronto Water's Waterfront Sanitary Servicing Master Plan, and this is a recently completed environmental assessment looking at sanitary servicing for the entire waterfront. What has been experienced the last 10 years is a massive amount of development in the downtown area that's putting a strain on the existing services. So what Toronto Water is trying to do is provide some clarity for their capital program over the next few decades in terms of coming up with the bigger pieces of infrastructure that are required in order to service the entire waterfront. Now, how that affects the Portlands is it basically tells us how we're going to replace the existing servicing and how we're going to tie it back to the Ash Bridges Bay Sewage Treatment Plant. So in terms of reality, constraints, and opportunities for the Portlands, we know it's a challenging site. We know it's in a floodplain, which we have to deal with. We know it needs extensive environmental remediation from the past uses. We know that we have poor ground conditions for building. Bedrock, which is what you need to build structures, is very low under the existing soil. So we need to go down there, which drives up the cost. We know the existing infrastructure is substandard. And we know that transit is not very good and needs to be improved.
So on that first point, here's the flood zone. So until this flood is taken care of, really nothing north of the ship channel can go forward. So all the planning approvals that happened in 2010, the official plan amendment, and everything that came before that, it all hinges on this one piece, which is the approval of the Don Map PA, which is the flood protection piece, which will allow for everything else to start happening. And just to give an indication of how that's already happened, let me see if this is going to work. Yes, so this is Don River Park. I showed you a rendering of that, and this is where the Pan Am Village is going. This is West Donlands. So we built the flood protection landform under the park, and then we built a park, and that flood protected all of this area. The intention now is to build a flood protection area by digging in rather than building up to flood protect all of this stone. So it gives you a sense of where we are. We've done one piece, this is the other piece, and both those pieces together will relieve the entire downtown from flood. So what are the opportunities?